It takes very special people to work in jails and prisons. I'm very fond of them. Well, let's all give ourselves a pat on the back. Whenever I get people calling me, asking me if they can work in jails and prisons, I say, well, there are some requirements. Lots of requirements. I went down the whole list, including security requirements, clearance and all that, good sense of humor, strong faith, good health. And one of the things I always say is perhaps one of the most important requirements for someone who's going to work in jail and prison is that they are able to sing Amazing Grace. If you can't sing Amazing Grace, you don't belong in the Correctional Ministry. That's a deal dropper right now. And not only that, there must be about 71 verses of Amazing Grace. And when I help out in parishes, they'll say, Father, you want to look at the hymnal and sing Amazing Grace? I think I know that one. So how about for our opening prayer, one verse of Amazing Grace? Huh?
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm gonna be found. I was blind,
Texas. I supervise the hundreds of men and women who work in the 51, get that number, 51 prisons and jails within our archdiocese. Not in the state, we have 126 state prisons, but in the archdiocese, 51 jails and prisons. I work at the Harris County Jail on the fifth floor with the inmates, where we currently have 10,000 men and women. In Texas, we don't do anything small, unfortunately. So, first of all, I just want to make sure that you don't hold the fact that I'm from Texas against me. We're not as crazy as we're made out to be. We don't shoot everyone we see. We don't carry all the time. And there are a lot of good and compassionate people, but I would advise this. If you're coming to visit us in Texas, bring your passport. Because you're coming to a very different country than Milwaukee or Wisconsin. So that's the first thing I want to say. Secondly, I do have some ties to Milwaukee. My mother was born in Beloit. My father was born in Janesville. I went to the seminary at the Sacred Heart School of Theology during his works. In fact, I was ordained by Archbishop Cousins in 1972. So I was a good one. In fact, I even lived in a little town called Oconomowoc. Have you heard of that? Oconomowoc? I also want to tell you something else. You know, I don't tell too many people this. I only went to Catholic school 1 year. And that was in Rolla, Missouri. That was in the 8th grade, and I got thrown out. I look back on it as a precursor to my years in jails. Sister Philanilla, who was the principal at St. Patrick's School in Rolla, Missouri, she told my parents that I would never amount to anything. So in passing out invitations to my ordination, I sent one in the hopes that Sister Philanilla would still be alive. One thing I found out about you religious sisters, who I admire tremendously, you never seem to die. said God works in mysterious. And I thought to myself, you got that right, girl. As a director of a jail and prison ministry, we have death row, by the way, in Texas death row in the diocese. I was very fascinated by Father George's work. Two big differences between St. Quentin and Texas death row. In Texas St. Quentin, California, y'all have like over 700 in jails in death row. We only have 425 right now because when you walk on the Texas death row, you don't come out. We kill you. We kill you. Over 540 have been executed since 1982. So, and as Director of Correctional Ministries, I know a lot of them as they come through the Harris County Jail, which is the death penalty capital. I have witnessed many executions. And when you put your hand on the leg of someone who's being executed, your life is forever changed. You just never get over it. But that's not what I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about a topic that's very near to me, and very dear to me, and unfortunately very alien to a lot of people who work in jails and prisons. The topic is reentry. What do you do with people when they're no longer in jail? What do you do with them? I have a friend of mine who works at NASA, the space agency. He knows a lot about reentry. The way he describes it, he says, it would make no sense whatsoever for us to send someone to the moon if we didn't have some way to bring them back safely. We are very good as a nation sending people to jail and prison. We haven't a clue on what to do with them once they're gone. And that's the sad reality, and it's an uncomfortable conversation because most of us will talk about our work in jails and in prisons, and it's wonderful. You know, I've been there for 30 years. I've been there, it's not there for 30 years. I passed out 1 million Bibles, 10,000 rosaries at least, you know, all sorts of pamphlets. And for me, what I see is what you see. So many of those people I give out Bibles and rosaries to come back, and they want another Bible, and they want another rosary. And the recycling continues. What do you do with people who come out of jail and prisons? And I have to ask you a very uncomfortable question. And that's why I had you laughing at the beginning, because this one's going to hurt. What good is it to go into jails and prisons? And what are you really accomplishing? If when you get in there, you tell them how wonderful they are, how good they are, and then when they leave, there's nothing there to reinform that. I can't tell you how many people my heart has gone out to. I've done whatever I could for them. I counsel them. I pray for them. I have 32 RCIA programs in the prisons. I have pastors who complain about having one. I have 32 of them. Last year in Correctional Ministries, we had over 960 masses offered for those in the prisons just within our archdiocese. We're very blessed with a lot of volunteers. We have Bible study. We have Acts retreats, Colby retreats. All these things, and that we keep seeing people come back and back and back. Now, let me give you some sobering statistics. And I'm not one for a lot of statistics, but this says it. This says it. Yeah, we have 2.2 million people in jails and prisons. We know that. Here's just as important a statistic. Over 7 million are free, but under supervision. They're under parole. They're under probation, they're under some form of mandatory supervision. What are we doing with these people? 95% of those who come out of jail and prison are going to come out of jail and prison. They're going to, you know, some of them are in for life sentences and death sentences, but 95% of those who are currently in jail and prison are coming out. Each year, 700,000 inmates are released. 700,000 inmates are released. 3 out of 4 will reoffend within 3 to 5 years. 75% of these people that we give Bibles to and rosaries to, and of those that reoffend, 60% of them will be convicted a second time. convicted a second time, it means more time. More time. I believe in the enormous power of God's grace. I believe that I wouldn't be a priest if I wasn't. I believe when we go into the jails and prisons, no word goes forth and returns without having done what God intends to do in prophecy. I believe that. And everything that we do that's successful in our ministry is not owed to us. It's owed to the grace of God. And you going into the jails and the prisons are doing incredible things, marvelous things that are so important as a foundation for coming out. But that's the foundation. And I think sometimes as jails and prison ministers, we get so, we feel good that we've done a lot of good stuff. We go home, and I gave out 80 Bibles today. Great. Of course, we're aware that the inmates probably sold about 60 of them. The commissary. And the other 20, someone's in there preaching the word that's enslaving everyone in the tank because they're misquoting scripture. Every time I give out a Bible, I get worried about what I'm giving out. You know, because that can be a very dangerous thing in the hands of those who misuse them for their own agenda. Okay. Do you know that, and I was struck by this, 25% of Americans have a criminal record. 25% of our population has a criminal record. So what do you do with people when they get out? Most of us, I would say, are Christians, and most of us are certainly Catholic. And we believe we're pro-life, right? But don't believe it for a second. I'm sorry, and I know this is being reported. I'm probably going to want to delete that somewhere down the line. I don't find us to be pro. I find us to be anti-abortion. Anti-abortion is not the same thing as pro-life. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Abortion with every ounce of energy we have, but we seem to be more interested in the unborn fetus than what happens when that child is born. We seem to lose interest in them once they're born. The state of Texas is a pro-life state. Yet we're number 48 in the nation in providing medical care for our children, number 50 in the United States in providing education for our children. These are the ones we want to make sure they're born, and then we lose interest in them once they're born. If you're going to be pro-life, let's be pro-life. All life is sacred. All life has a purpose. And I think we have to look at Jesus, who is the prototype of what we are supposed to be about, and what we're doing, and how we're to do it, to find that reality. Jesus eats with sinners. The scribes and Pharisees thought that was one of the greatest accusations they could make against Jesus. He loved it. In fact, I should have little stickers. I eat with sinners. I enjoy hanging around with sinners. But when you take a look at what Jesus does, it's always about, you're not interested whether you're guilty or innocent. I'm not interested if you go to church or not. I'm not interested in whether you pay Catholic Radical or not. I'm just interested in, do you love me? And are you willing to accept my forgiveness for you and move on with your life so that you can be an instrument of redemption and salvation? A light to the world. That's why I forgive you. You're a good person. You know why you're a good person? Because I created you. And God doesn't create children. And that's the reality, huh? The gold standard for why we should be getting involved with helping those who get out of jail and prison are not only the things that Jesus does, for example, when he heals the lepers. Why is he healing the lepers? Well, out of compassion. But the leprosy is keeping them away from their families and society, and so he wants them to come home. When he raises the young man of the widow of Nain, he's doing it out of a sense of compassion, and he's teaching us about resurrection. But what he's really doing is restoring this woman's place in society, because that's her only son, and without a son, she is lost. And so he raises the young man to bring her home so that the family can be whole again. In the story of the prodigal son, we got a story about a kid who's really mean. man, I wouldn't want to be about this kid. He wants his old man to die so he can get his money. Not exactly what we preach on a Sunday. And so he says, I want it now. And the father says, here, it's going to break my heart. Well, the young man leaves, and a father under Jewish law has no responsibilities to the son anymore. He can be a good Jew and never have anything more to do with his son. But he chooses to do something different. Each day he goes out looking for his son. Wow, what a message right there. If we're going to work with people who have been in jail and prison, we can't sit in our offices and wait for them to come to us. We got to go after them. Huh? Just as we have to go after those who are victims of crime. You know what happens to victims of crime? They hide from the world. They're embarrassed, they're ashamed. We need to go after them. We need to get out of our offices and out of our administration and say we're all pro-life and all that. Yeah, yeah, you need to go find those people who don't feel they have much of a life anymore. The father goes get the son. He brings him back and restores him to his rightful place. What good is forgiveness without restoration? Please tell me that. What good is forgiveness if it doesn't mean a restoring to a person's rightful place? Ah, but there's a fly in the ointment. And we know what the fly in the ointment is. I'll save that for a second. There's another parable about the 99 sheep. Ah, the good sheep. The ones that are hanging tough with the pastor. The ones who form the parish council, the ones who are, I mean, they're the good ones. We see there every Sunday, they're the electors. Ah, where's the pastor? He's out looking for so-and-so? Oh, not again. The ladies' fidelity is having a meeting tonight. Father was supposed to lead the opening prayer. And there he is out there with his sheep who's never contributed a dime to the community. Ah, yeah, the sheep aren't really happy about this. Pastor goes out and looks for the sheep, and he brings him back. And in one of the accounts, it says, and the 99 rejoiced. Give me a break. Get down to heaven that way. It does not happen that way. The sheep don't want this one back. They've already cut their losses. We can do without this one. And while we laugh, it's the reality. Do you want a sex offender living in your neighborhood next door? Oh, okay, now it's beginning to hit home, huh? You want somebody who's been a lifelong criminal living down your block? And we even Google who's in our neighborhood to make sure that those who are coming back aren't going to be trusted. Well, we need to be aware of those nasty people who are coming back. In the story of the prodigal son, you got the kid. I go to church every Sunday. You know, I'm a good person. And the father says, don't worry, you'll get yours. You'll get yours. What the father in the story knows and the pastor knows is this. And if you don't pick up anything that I'm saying today, it's this. They both know that without the return of the lost son or the lost sheep, that community and that family will never be everything that it is called to be. In other words, they're going after these people, not necessarily because we want them back, but the community needs them to make them whole. We follow what St. Paul says in describing the church. He says, we are a mystical body with Christ as our head. When every member of the body is functioning well, the whole body functions beautifully. But when one person does not function well, the whole body suffers. We live in a country that's becoming more and more exclusive. We're losing our sense of welcome everyone. We even hear that in the church. I mean, there's an archbishop, and I'm not gonna mention his name. He gave a talk about 3 weeks ago. He says, I think we would be better off if we had a scholar church of holier people. I'm sorry, that's an archbishop, and I don't buy into that. That's not my church, and that's not the Church of Christ. I mean, what are we supposed to do? Narrow the church down to just 11 of us? So that when Jesus comes back, we can say, look, you only have to have one bus to take us to heaven, right? The message of the church is that I will not suffer even the loss of one individual. And that's the vision that you and I have to have. In working in jails and prisons, you must be a prophet. preaching a message that is countercultural to the values of our society. A society that says if you're not productive, you're disposable. Right. Elderly people, hey, I'm there, you know. You better get up and walk. You better walk down here or else you're out of here. And we might make it even easier for you to die. We call it euthanasia. Isn't one of the reasons why we oppose abortion so strongly is because we're saying we're destroying potential. We need this person to be born. They may be the light of the world that Christ is calling for. They may be the one that heals cancer. Every life has value. And when the body has everyone involved in things, it rejoices and it functions the way it's supposed to be. And when we're about the business of excluding people because they don't meet our criteria, we become less. This is the selfie society. The Holy Father talks about it. Me. And so many times our parish is all about those good people who show up every Sunday. Well, there's a whole world out there of people who have come out of prison and don't feel comfortable coming into the gym because they got tattoos. I mean, talk about tattoos. Lord have mercy. I can't imagine the pain threshold these people have. Tattoos on their eyelids. And my favorite tattoos are the ones that the guys have their girlfriend on their neck. A girlfriend that they broke up with about 5 years ago. Yeah. So, we need to have a vision. Those of us who work in jails and prisons, that is prophetic. That the reason why I go into jail is not, wow, you're really something, Father. I wouldn't do it. You're just a wonderful person to do it. Well, I know I am. I know. But the reality is, I go in to find people who inspire me many times. Inmates inspire me all the time. I mean, I'm really down and discouraged. I say, there, Father, you'll get better. And I say, I think that's supposed to be my line. I really love working with sinners. I think that's why I was ordained. I certainly identify with them. And we should be too. But my spiritual director says, you need to be careful, Ron. And when you go into a jail and you preach the message that every one of them had value and every one of them had purpose, you feel the wind of the Holy Spirit behind your message. But as far as the world is concerned, you're spitting into the wind and it's going to come back all over again. The sheep don't want people back from prison. And that's a harsh reality. We need to deal with it. And those of you who are pastors, you need to wake up to that reality. If you want to get involved in reentry, you're going to fight a lot of opposition. A lot of opposition. It is easier for me to go into jail and prison than it is to get involved with those who are getting out. It's much harder work. Much harder work. To understand what it is that we need to do with regard to providing reentry help, you need to understand some of the causes of why people become. There is a wonderful article written by the Congressional Research Office. It's called Offender Reentry Correction Statistics. It was given to Congress in January 2015. At that time, there was still some interest in reentry. There was actually bipartisan support for developing something. I am on an advisory committee with Senator John Cornyn from Texas. We met several times. Then a funny thing happened, the election. And this election's gone on forever. God. You know, for 18 months, everything in Congress shut down with regard to discussing bipartisanship and reentry. Everything shut down. And I don't want to be really political, but it looks like dark days ahead for the reentry. That ain't gonna fly in the next whatever years. I'm sorry. I talk about spitting into the wind. And I have a lot of spittle. What are the reasons why people come back? One, they're mentally ill. They're mentally ill. 60% of those who are in our jails and prisons have mental health issues. Our jails and our prisons have become the mental health facilities of our country. It's scary. In the Harris County Jail, we have 10,000 inmates. 65% of them are mentally ill. We are the largest mental health facility in the state of Texas, the Harris County Jail. What are we doing there? These are the people we're going to get out. And what's waiting for them? What's waiting for them? I mean, even if we make sure that they have proper medication when they get out, who's going to supervise them to make sure they don't sell the medication? And on a smaller level, with regard to mental health, the congressional statement says what we should be providing for those who get out of prison are some kind of attitude behavioral classes in which people learn how to manage stress, how to handle anger, how to set goals, all these kinds of issues that those who are suffering from mental health cannot do. And now they're faced with these problems in the outside world. If a parish just simply provides those kinds of things for those coming out of jail or prison, you can reduce recidivism very effectively. We all know that. So many people tell me, I want to kill somebody. And I have that feeling all the time. Okay, well, God bless you now. Let me give you a blessing, let's move on. I hope you don't kill me. And then they go out into the free world and we think, magically they're going to change. No, they're not. They're not. How naive can we be? If we're not involved with those who are mentally ill and finding out what we can do for them when we get out, we're wiping out 60% of those currently in jail and prison. And they're going to be on your streets. On your streets. God only knows doing. Secondly, and this is something that I find, I really enjoyed Amalia's talk on the families of those who are affected by jail and prison. Ideally, when an individual comes out of jail and prison, they can go home. They can go home. I mean, that's what we're kind of shooting for. But you need to understand something, and I know you do. Many of the families that they come from are horribly dysfunctional. So the inmate goes into jail and prison. They go to church, they get a Bible, they get a rosary, they get some counseling, they get GED, they go to substance abuse classes, they're sober, they get out, and they cannot go home again because their family is poison, is poison. And so as a counselor, I said, whatever you do, don't go home. I know that sounds strange, but the family hasn't received anything while their family member has been in jail or prison. So what good is all we're doing here if we say, now we want you to go back into that dysfunctional place, and wow, you know? And quite frankly, a lot of families don't want their loved ones back. That's another little ugly secret. I like to feel that everyone's standing outside waiting for their loved one to come home. But I hear mothers and fathers calling me all the time, saying, I'm so happy my son's in prison. I at least know where he is at night. When he's home, the children don't go to school anymore, and there's always a police car in front of the house. So, Father, is it okay for me to say I'm glad my son's in jail? I say, sure, I understand. I understand. One reason why people come back is whereas you and I see our homes as centers of stability and hope, a lot of inmates don't. And so what do we do for those who come out in reasonably good health? And you know that old Thomas Wolfe novel, we can't go home again. For many of the inmates, they can't go home. There's nothing there for them. Another problem is no jobs. No jobs. Or at least no jobs of any significance. Okay? No jobs. If you ever work with those who are getting out of jail, here's a huge problem. I have inmates say, I'll have no trouble at all getting a job when I get out. And I thought, really? We live in the land of denial. And I said, what did you do when you were in jail? Well, I was a waiter at, Red Pepper or whatever. And I said, you're not going to be able to work there anymore. You're a sex offender. You're not going to get a job there. Oh, Father, I know a lot of people. I know you do. And half of them are dead. So what are you going to do? Without a job, you have problems in reentry. Have real, real problems. Many of them leave jail and prison with very little education, very little. Yeah, they get a GED in some jails and prisons, and they can even write away for some college educations and all that, but they have no on their feet kind of education, you know, practical, dealing with social issues, how to present yourself at a job, how to write a resume, how to even look good so that when you walk into church, You don't terrify the whole congregation by the way you look, you know, and the way you smell. Education. Most of them have substance abuse problems. And they get out and they go to AA and they go to NA. But here's what I find out. So many of them try to make up for lost time. And they think that their way of doing that is get two jobs, get three jobs. And he said, well, are you going to church? I haven't been able to because I got two jobs. And I'm going to get a third job. Good for you. Are you going to NA? Can't because I got two jobs. And I got to get three jobs. And then I got to report to the parole officer. They got time for everything except coming to AA and NA. And boy, is that a red flag. Is that a red flag? Their priorities are screwed up. Yeah, I think it's only natural that when you've been in prison for so long, you want to make up for lost time. And I think one of the speakers said it so very well. You cannot make up for lost time. You cannot make up for the past. You know, no matter what you do, you're never going to be able to repay the damage you did to others. And what you need to do is leave it in the hands of God, do whatever you can to apologize, make restitution, and then you need to move on with your life. But you can't speed up your life in order to make up for lost time. It just doesn't work that way. I could give a whole conference on reentry, but those are some of the main causes for recidivism. Another one is they have no place to live. They have no place to live. If you get out and you apply for a job, one of the first questions they ask you is, what is your permanent residence? I don't have one. Then I'm not going to hire you. Years ago, when I became so involved, I went through a period of real depression working in jail. Just giving out Bibles all the time, rosaries all the time, and ordering more that I couldn't afford. Giving it to people that I wasn't quite sure what they were going to do with. And I think, there's something more to my life than this. I've got to help people when they get out find a place to live. Because I kept hearing people call me all the time. Father, I'm out now. Hey, great. I know what the next line's going to be. You know, need some help. What kind of help? Fringe on the phone. Need some money. Can I give you $20? That ain't going to cut it. Can you find me a place to live? So 10 years ago in Correctional Ministries, we developed three halfway houses. Isaiah House, Providence House for men, Angela House for women. We received no money at all from the diocese. I went to my bishop, who's a fine man and who supports Correctional Ministries, and I asked him for some financial help. But the first words that came out of his mouth were the first words that, if I was your pastor and you came to me, I would ask, who's going to pay for the liability insurance? I was hoping you would. The diocese says, well, we're going to be affiliated with you. Oh, I know that chart, and that doesn't mean nothing. But we can't afford to take liability insurance on that. It would be just cost prohibitive. I know, because we run three of them, and the insurance is incredible to pay. And it's one reason why a lot of people don't get involved in transitional housing. To put people with high risk issues in neighborhoods, you're just asking for trouble. You really are. These houses have been open for 10 years. We've had 500 people come through them. We make sure they have a job. We get them a job. They don't sit and watch TV. Oh no, when you come to Isaiah House, when you come to Providence House or Angela House, we get you a job. We expect that you work at that job hard. We expect that you go to substance abuse classes, and we ask that you go to church. In the national recidivism rate, those who return to prison, 61%. In the state of Texas, those who go back to prison, 55%. In the 10 years that we've had Isaiah House and Providence House open, and Angela House, our recidivism rate is 4.68. Transitional housing. It makes a difference, a huge difference. Huge difference, I have to say. But here's the problem. Oh, listen, I'm not advocating you all get into it. It's a headache. I mean, I've got Tums in my pocket right now. I never go anywhere without Tums. And ammonium, too, if you're going to be in charge of it. But first of all, you got to find people who are going to be your directors of these houses. Oh yeah, here we go. I'll give you an idea of who I've got. My director of Isaiah House and a Providence House is a former ex-Marine. And for the women?
Oh, yeah.
I've got a woman who is a nun.
Oh, nuns are tough.
They're very good transitional housing directors. But this one's even better, because not only is she a religious sister, but she used to be a Chicago cop. I hit the jackpot. This is the dream. This is who I've got running these places, and this is why they do so well. You're going to meet people incredibly tough. Tough love, but tough. Every night when you get a phone call from Isaiah House or Providence House or Angela House, you just wait like, please, who left, got in trouble with the neighborhood, and now the neighborhood wants us out. You just kind of live on the edge all the time. Have you ever worked with somebody who comes out of jail or prison? Oh, it's unbelievable. You practically have to adopt them. You have to adopt them. The first one I ever became involved in, his name was Christopher. I raised $6,000 from a parish. Boy, was I naive. We're going to rehabilitate Christopher. God love us. Okay. I was able to find him a small apartment. It didn't work out well because it was all around druggies and he got involved with drugs. Then I took him shopping. Food shopping. I had my Roman collar on and my suit on, and I took Christopher shopping. We went to the fresh fruit section, and he said, what's that? I said, it's a plum. It's a plum. Christopher had been in prison for 24 years. And I said, have you ever had a plum? Never had one. Try one. So he's about ready to eat. I said, no, not here. In the bag, without a shot with the charge added to everything else. He finally found some fruit that he liked. It was apples. And I said, Christopher, you like apples? I like apples. He took one. He put it in the bag. And I said, Christopher, what are you going to do with that apple? He says, I'm going to eat it tonight. And I said, well, what are you going to do tomorrow? The thought hadn't struck him that maybe he should get six. The idea of planning for the next day was difficult for Christopher. We did this for about an hour and a half, standing in front of bread. Finally, we ended up with Wonder Bread, plain white, just take that, bread. By then, I was losing my patience. Because originally, I thought, I'm going to let him make the choices, I'm not going to become involved, I'm going to stand back. And I thought, no, this is my whole life. We need to speed up this process. Took an hour and 15 minutes to go shopping, and this is not a lie. When I dropped Christopher off, I went to confession. After an hour and 15 minutes shopping, I thought my soul was in dire danger. Working with those who are coming out of jail and prison is a real task because they're so used to being told what to do and how to do it. Oh my goodness. We have an inmate at the Isaiah House. His name is Gator. I don't think that's his real name, but I've never looked at his birth certificate. He was on death row. He was on death row, and he appealed this case, was found guilty again, but the sentencing, they gave him a life sentence instead of capital punishment. So he was eligible for parole. He had been on death row for 28 years, and he'd been in prison in other places before. The Department of Pardons and Paroles called me and asked if we would take Gator. I said, sure. What the heck, you know, all in. All in, if you're not all in, you probably shouldn't be in this business. So here comes Gator. Great guy. Gator, when he grew up, worked on a farm. So he knows how to drive a tractor and other things. And before he went to death row, he worked in a prison system on a tractor and things like that. But Gator had never gotten a driver's license. Never. During this whole process, he'd never gotten one. And not only that, Gator didn't know how to read. Gator didn't know how to read, you know. Well, we got a real problem here. I mean, we're trying to put his life back together, and one of the key components is going to be his ability to drive. But he can't read. The guys in the halfway house stepped up. I was so proud of them. They said, we're going to teach Gator how to rain just enough so that he can pass his driver's test. I said, better you than me. I'm off, I got to say mass somewhere else. Good luck. Gator called me maybe 3 months later, crying hysterically on the phone. I said, Gator, what's going on? He said, I can drive. I passed the test. I said, wow, God. And I thought, now who can I tell about this? Who can I tell? Should I talk Paul Cardinal? Who am I going to tell about these great things that happened in my ministry? That's a problem for us, isn't it? Because most people get glassy-eyed when they think, like, we must be exaggerating. Someone asked me once, Father, you need to write a book about your experiences. I thought, who would believe it? And so I went out there, and there's Gator. A Baptist church bought him a used car. He's now going to their church. Gator's now left Isaiah House, and he's got a job as a truck driver. And he thinks, good for Gator. And here's the thing, Gator keeps coming back just to touch base with us from time to time. He shows up at lunchtime. We trained him well. And he's one of our success stories. I don't want to say to you that if you get involved in reentry, you're not going to have success stories. You're going to have one after another. But you got to take a real risk to get involved in it. You really have to. So what can you do? Okay, I'm going to give you some ideas about what you can do to get involved with reentry. Because I know many of you, it's enough for you to go into the jails and prisons. And it's a difficult thing to do. Number one, you have to have the mindset that I've been talking about, that you're a prophet, that you have to be about the business of everything you do whenever you go into jail or prison, preparing the inmate, whoever it is, for reentry, because he's going to get out. It's not enough for you, to quote scripture, it's not enough for you to do these things. From the moment you start contact with them, you have to start preparing them to get out. And what does that mean? Well, you need to ask them, are they going to substance abuse classes in the jail? Are they going to NA? Are they going to church? Can they possibly get a GED? And every time you see them, while you want to quote the scriptures and pray for them, you need to ask them those questions, because we're trying to get you ready so that you can get out. But you have to have that mindset that that is your function. That when you go into a jail or prison, you have got to start preparing them to get out. Secondly, you need to educate yourself. What is available in your communities? What is available? You don't want to get involved in any kind of activity in which you are reinventing the wheel. There are resources out there. And the last thing we want are competing, reentry groups. Because I'm jealous of your group, I'm not going to cooperate. It's hard to get people who have halfway houses to sit down and talk about how we can share resources, because they're so afraid that I've only got a halfway house with one person, and you got halfway houses with 52 people, and I'm relying on a halfway house for my income. I don't want to talk to you about it. And so you have a lot of these fly-by-night halfway houses that aren't doing much good. And so you need to educate yourself as to, does Catholic Charities do anything that might be termed reentry stuff? Does your parish do anything? What about other churches, mental health facilities? You need to be the center of information for the inmates, okay? So that when you go in and talk with them, like we have booklets that we make up and we give it to them and say, these are available resources, and we're always trying to update them because these places go out of business all the time. But if there's one person who should in your community know what's already there so that you can tell the inmates about it, it's you. And so you become a source of information. And that takes a long time to gather. A lot of visits to the churches and communities, find out, what are you doing for those who are mentally ill and coming out? What are you doing for jobs? Just get your information. Give it to the inmate so that they're armed with that kind of information. Third, you need to go to your local community and educate your community. And that may be your pastor. And say, Father, we really love you. But there's a whole group of people out there that we're not dealing with. And Father says, I don't want to hear that. I got enough problems here. I got 2 weddings, a quinceanera, and 3 funerals. I know that. But we got people wandering around the streets thinking they might want to kill somebody. And there are our brothers and sisters. What can we do as a community? And then maybe get together, hopefully with the pastor and other members of the community, to say, we'd like to form just an informative group to find out what's available, and maybe unite yourself with other, you know, don't get yourself involved in any activities for some time. You need to educate yourself, first of all. Find out who's really serious about making the commitment to do that. And then take the plunge. Maybe in a small way, you know, maybe providing the counseling classes at your parish for those who are getting out. It's not going to be easy because you're going to have to find out who's getting out. You're going to have to go into your neighborhood and find out who's gotten out. These are the classes we offer. A small thing like that, and many of you are qualified to do that. You know, many of you have degrees in psychology and counseling and all that. Wow, we would be very good at providing classes for those who come out of jail in prison on the issue of stress management, managing a budget, how to take your medications and all that, and bring in people from the mental health community to help you and assist you. These are small things. And I would not suggest that you get involved in transitional housing for a while. It took us 3 years to find the first building. 3 years. The fourth year, the second house fell in place. There was a wonderful lady who worked in jail and prison and said, we need to find housing for these people that I'm working with. I'm like, God bless you. She had an apartment complex. She opened up the apartment complex for ex-offenders. She put a TV and a little refrigerator in each room. And I thought, wow, I'd like to live here. Well, they came and they stole. Everything disappeared. Now, she's not the easiest kind of woman to say no to. She went out and bought a whole new batch of refrigerators and TVs. They came and they stole. So she came to me and she said, Father, I don't know what to do. I said, well, you can give me that house. And I just tossed that out as a joke. She said, okay, I'll give you the house. I said, really? Ask, I've heard it said, ask and you shall receive. Wow, this is wonderful. She said, I just have one stipulation. I said, okay, here it comes, here it comes. She said, name it Providence House. I said, girl, I'd name it anything. Well, that name of circus, and you want it. And so Providence House got its start that way. Well, they don't have private rooms, and they don't have an individual TV, and they don't have refrigerators. Okay? And they're doing just fine. Just fine. I could go on for days, but I know that you got lunch. And a good speaker never tries to cut into someone's lunchtime. Okay? I want to leave you on a personal note. Personal note. And this may not have anything but all to do with the issue of reentry. But I want you to hear it anyways. You're looking at one very happy priest. You really are. I've been ordained for 43 years. I've been pastor of 4 parishes. And that's one of the nice things about working in jail and prison. I tell the pastors, I don't have a parish council. I don't have to build anything. And we have a program in our diocese called DSF that each pastor is allotted to collect for the services of the poor. So I don't have to collect it. I get to spend it. I get to spend it. And every night when I go to bed, I know where my parishioners are. You're looking at a really happy priest. It hasn't always been that way. I have discovered along the line that the happiness comes down to this. Knowing that what you're doing is what God created you to do. Happiness is using the gifts that God has given you to do it. And being comfortable, knowing that the rest of God will help you succeed then. I belong in jail. I belong in jail! And my mother told me that when I was being raised. She was a very smart woman. Very smart. You belong in jail and prison. We are called. just a good word with joy. God has touched our hearts. He's called us in ways that others would not say yes to. Celebrate that, and in your prayer, reflect on that all the time. And understand that, you know, everything you do will produce great fruit. We're coming to the end of the year of mercy. You know, God's mercy never ends. It endures forever. How good it is to be one of his followers. How good it is to not only be the recipient of his mercy, but one who can show it in the way we love each other. We're not a happy priest. I hope that comes across. Thank you, brothers and sisters. Thank you very much.